So we're scared of being exposed. We live in a smaller community here in Temecula, but people are, you know, commuting to the larger cities. Most people are showing up known after the fact. They didn't know they were around known people.
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Is there preventative measures that people can take when they're in those more risky areas?
So when you're in a highly densely populated area, just really be very vigilant on all things hygiene-wise. You know, washing your hands really frequently. If you touch a lot of stuff, most of our jobs now are really sedentary, but they involve a keyboard or a tablet or a phone or something where you're touching an object a lot of times a day. So you really want to be very mindful of pretty much everything you touch. That just starting there would be a really, really, really big win for every individual and subsequent community involved.
What advice would you give parents right now to either protect their kids, or do they have something to worry about even?
So I would want to caution parents to worry necessarily. I don't think that it's a need to, you know, worry and, you know, just put your kids in a bathtub and leave them there. I don't think that that's the necessary, you know, route to take. I do think that limiting, you know, school assemblies, and obviously if they're canceling school, then they've already done that job for you, to really limit the amount of times in which your kid is exposed to large groups. What I would say for the folks that carpool or you know, use public transportation and those things, I would really encourage you to really look out for the sick people. If you are coming down with anything as an individual, do everybody a favor and just stay at home that day, okay? I wouldn't, you know, consistently hand out perfect attendance trophies, but we don't need to do that in this particular environment. So there's probably not going to be a whole lot of difference symptomatically from the big flu and the coronavirus flu. The difference, but it tends to be the terminology that folks use as far as the flu and just a viral cold, because the cold and the flu are two different things. And I think there's a little bit of misinformation between those two.
And so what are some symptoms that are real indicators of a flu versus a cold?
So a cold, generally, you know, it starts off, you might have had notice a cough, kid or relative or something, you know, feeling a little down, tends to get on you a little bit. You may feel a little tired, a little fatigued, appetite may be a little bit down. The worst part is about day three, day four, and then you start to kind of turn it around with some over-the-counter things, Tylenol cold and sinus, some Sudafed, and then you really just kind of turn it around in about a week's time. The flu tends to really knock you down. I mean, the general cough and cold, you can still kind of go to work. You can kind of rough it through, coughing in your arm and sneezing and stuff, and you just get home and go to sleep. But the flu really just takes a lot of energy out of you. Not to mention, it does sometimes combine with some diarrhea, some nauseousness, which doesn't make you eat. And therein lies how people land in the hospital, because that kind of cough, those respiratory effects that take on your lungs, it starts to compromise your breathing. And if it compromises your breathing, it compromises your eating. Compromising your eating, you don't have a good enough buildup of electrolytes and fluid and nutrients that your body needs on a daily basis, which is where the hospital comes in and steps in with IV fluids and medication. So 0 to 100, 0 being you don't need to go anywhere, to 100 being you need to go to the hospital. Most of your people kind of end up in this 0 to 50 or 60 kind of range, which is where you feel a little down, you feel a little lethargic maybe. You're not vomiting, you're not having any diarrhea, you're not breathing, it's not hard for you to breathe. You can go to your urgent care and your primary care doctors to get good solutions for those issues. Primarily, more than likely, it's probably not corona, but it might be something else that can be solved. So that's where kind of your 0 to 60, 0 to 70-ish kind of range is. Now your 7 to 100 range, if you have a, if you have diabetes, if you have COPD, if you have asthma, if you have, if you're taking medication that compromises your immune system, you're already somewhat behind the eight ball on any infection that you get. But if you start to come down with those coughs, with those colds, with that achiness, with that fatigue and overall general tiredness, then I would be, have a low threshold for that particular patient population, elderly would be included in that, that they would need to go to the hospital. Breathing becomes an overall issue, and coughing is a thing that can really, really start to impact your overall energy level and cough, or in an activity level, then that is when you would go to the hospital. And then you'd get assessed, we get x-rays, we get a lot of different things there to best make sure you get the needs that are met. But not everybody needs to go to the hospital. A lot of these issues can be solved by going to your urgent cares or your primary care doctor and really just honing in on then doing the regular things that your local pharmacy or grocery store can provide. So to the elderly population specifically, I would really encourage you to already, symptoms or no symptoms, to somewhat do a bit of some self-quarantine, because you need to limit the amount of exposure that you have to any and everybody else that may be just a carrier of the virus. And that's just the best thing that you can do. Most elderly people also tend to be retired. That tends to help out with that self-quarantine part. Get your groceries delivered, maybe not go to the grocery store. Go ahead and skip church this week. And if you do happen to have one of those high risk medical conditions, then definitely go see your doctor if your symptoms aren't that bad. But if they are, then you need to go to the hospital. So this is obviously a time of heightened awareness, and if things keep going on the trajectory that they are, which is schools potentially closing down, events, dances, barbecues, and other things that are community driven, that where we want and like and need to be, you know, the human spirit needs to be around people, particularly people that make you feel good. I mean, these are good big events. I think this is an opportunity to go ahead and, you know, focus on yourself a bit. Take some time, read that book that you've been kind of struggling through to finish. You know, spend time with family, obviously. Hopefully they're not sick. And really, you know, watch that documentary that's too long that you don't get a chance to finish all the time. And really just take some time to, you know, either build on or start something new and add something new that you haven't been doing that your every day-to-day doesn't allow you to do. So when you look at the different patient populations, and this is all, which is where you get your folks explaining kind of epidemiology as far as the approach to this. Temecula, albeit big, is not a highly densely populated area where you have people cramming on subways, buses, trains, working in big tall skyscraper, you know, buildings where we're stuffing in an elevator and cubicles everywhere and all of those types of scenarios. That's a large city. Your Los Angeles's, San Diego's, San Francisco's, New York's, Atlanta's, Chicago's, those types of areas are your really, really densely populated areas. People are shoulder to shoulder, literally. Temecula's not like that. Now, for the folks that commute to work in places like those, yeah, there we get back to the whole prevention and the risk and what we want to limit as far as exposure goes. Five things that people can do is definitely wash your hands. Try to limit yourself in large groups. If you do feel sick, make sure you stay at home and self-quarantine yourself without having to be told. Really stay abreast on what's happening in your own individual community. And lastly, I really would just say, take this moment to really take it all in and learn how science, overall community health works and affects all people involved. I would really want people to take that to be a really big takeaway from this entire coronavirus pandemic as it stands.